Hello and welcome to Forgotten America, a podcast about the many places that get flown over, driven past, or just plain forgotten, and the people who call these places home. In each episode, we'll diagnose the unique challenges faced by rural America and unpack and explore the solutions to those challenges. We'll also share the culture, stories, and perspectives of forgotten Americans, from the hilltop to the holler and the desert to the delta. This episode of Forgotten America opens with a brief walk down memory lane. Garrett shares how he first met Dr. Thompson at his Moral Foundations of Capitalism seminar at Clemson University. Dr. Thompson's lecture was a catalyst moment for Garrett that led him down a career path that brought him home to run the Cardinal Institute for West Virginia Policy, a free market think tank. Dr. Bradley Thompson was born in Canada, but he considered himself an American born in the wrong country from a young age. He shares how hitchhiking through the United States was a formative experience and explains that he chose to explore rural America this way for two reasons: to discover America and to discover himself. This episode of the Forgotten America podcast explores the origins of Dr. Thompson's Substack entitled Redneck Intellectual, how COVID impacted a generation of young men and women, what makes classical education unique, and the importance of fatherhood. If you enjoy thinking about the big questions of life, this episode is one that you won't want to miss.
Welcome, everybody, back to another edition of the Forgotten America podcast. As ever, I am your host, Garrett Ballinger, and I am joined today by a very special guest, Dr. C. Bradley Thompson of Clemson University. Sir, thank you for joining us today.
It's great to be with you.
So you and I, we actually go way, way back. You probably don't remember this, but you have a fantastic seminar called the Moral Foundations of Capitalism at Clemson University. And I remember I was sort of an interested undergraduate at my institution in Morgantown, West Virginia, WVU. And an econ professor said, Garrett, you really need to check out the seminar. It's fantastic. I had no idea what it was. I was more interested in kind of finance and that kind of thing. So I get to the beautiful campus that is Clemson University, and your seminar sort of opened my eyes to an alternative way of viewing the world. Could you just tell, to the extent you want to, could you tell folks about the Moral Foundations of Capitalism seminar at Clemson? Is that something you guys still do?
Well, actually, we don't do it. And I need to ask you a question to make sure I have the dates correct, because that will determine which conference we were doing. Mm-hmm. So approximately when were you at Clemson for this conference?
I think it was 07, 08 in the summer.
Okay. All right. So 07, 08, that means we would have been doing what we called our Atlas Shrugged and the Moral Foundations of Capitalism summer conference for college students. Mm-hmm. And I think that year we had maybe 25 or 30 very bright young men and women from around the United States. And the requirement for all the students was that they read Ayn Rand's classic novel, Atlas Shrugged, and come in, and it was a highly intensive seminar. You know, we started at 8 o'clock in the morning and went till 10 o'clock at night for 3 days. And we blasted our way through this 1200 page novel. And then we also, on top of going through the novel, we also had 3 or 4 lectures every day on the moral foundations of capitalism. And it's our view that the single most important need in today's world is a moral defense of capitalism, because that moral defense is the one thing that is lacking. We've got lots of great economists out there who are defending capitalism in economic terms, but we've really never had a moral defense of capitalism in our culture, other than, I think, the novel Atlas Shrugged. So The purpose of that conference was to inspire young men and women, college-age students, not only to read Atlas Shrugged, but to be able to articulate a strong moral defense of capitalism.
Oh, fantastic. And I think you certainly did that for me, because as I mentioned to you whenever we were going in the back and forth over email, that I really was planning on going into the finance world. That was what my major was in. That's what I was interested in. I got there and I thought, wow, this is really different. And so that sort of catalyzed my interest. And now I've been working in the Liberty Movement for 15 years. And so, including leading a think tank in my home state. So as I said in the email, thank you for that. That was, you definitely kind of changed the course of my life, I think, in some ways. I remember the question that probably gave my professor the idea that I needed to go to this conference. He had asked on a test, who do you think has created more value for the world, Mother Teresa or Bill Gates? And I think I was one of the only ones that had just sort of instinctively chosen Bill Gates. And I made the argument why Bill Gates actually did that. And so now I'm kind of putting it all together about why he thought I needed to go down to Clemson.
Yeah, I mean, creating wealth is more important than redistributing wealth. And redistributing wealth is what Mother Teresa and all socialists do. But they cannot redistribute wealth unless it's been created. And people like Bill Gates and Steve Jobs and Henry Ford and John D. Rockefeller, all of the great industrialists and capitalists in American history, they are the ones who are more responsible for bringing millions, if not tens of millions of people out of poverty than anybody else, right? You can only redistribute, or at least, I mean, I don't support certainly the forced redistribution of wealth under any circumstances. But what I do, of course, support is charity. And you cannot have charity unless you have the wealth to share. And that's why it's important to have free market economies to allow individuals to make as much wealth as they possibly can.
So, Brad, I think people can already get a sense of the fact that you're just an interesting person. You're an interesting thinker, and you write a very interesting newsletter and Substack that we're going to get to here in just a second called the Redneck Intellectual. But before we get there, can you just give our listeners a sense of kind of what your background is? Are there any formative moments that you can kind of point to that were responsible for you being here today and kind of thinking about the world in the ways that you do? Again, it's a little bit different. It's a little bit unusual. So kind of rewind it for everybody. What kind of caused your evolution?
Well, I would say the first thing is I was born and raised in Canada. I was born in Niagara Falls, Ontario, the honeymoon capital of the world. And when I was 7 years old, I read a children's book called The How and Why Wonder Book of the American Revolution. When I finished that book, I knew I was an American born in the wrong country. And from that time, I was, 7, 8, 9 years old, I became fascinated with the United States. Was especially fascinated when I was in high school. I would, on Saturdays, I would borrow my dad's car and leave the house at 5 o'clock in the morning. And I remember in high school driving to Morgantown, West Virginia, just because I wanted to see Morgantown. I wanted to see some slice of America. And I was also influenced actually in high school by a second book called, it was published by National Geographic. It was a photograph book called The Mountain People of America. At least half, if not two thirds of that book was about Appalachia. And it appeared to be a world completely different than my own. And I was just fascinated with it. And I have no doubt that my trips down to West Virginia when I was in high school were partly as a result of reading this National Geographic book on Appalachia. So I always had this kind of love and fascination with the United States. When I was in high school, I started hitchhiking all over Canada and then into the United States. So for instance, my senior year of high school, I got a ride down to Florida during March break. But then I hitchhiked back from Daytona Beach to Canada during March, the middle of March. And I went, I didn't take any major highways. I just took secondary highways, and I explicitly went along sort of the Appalachian Mountains. So there was a highway called Highway 219, which then turns into Highway 119, I think, that basically extends. It goes actually, from Georgia up through a little bit of maybe South Carolina, certainly North Carolina, West Virginia, and then into Pennsylvania, and then to Buffalo, which is the terminus point for me. And it was an extraordinary trip. It took 3 days. The middle of March, which is where we are right now, of course, in Appalachia, sometimes doesn't have the best weather. By the way, I should also note that this was March of 1978. So it was a long time ago, and America was a lot different in 1978, and rural Appalachia was different than it is today. And again, for a young man from a different country, rural Appalachia in 1978 was just like the most fascinating place in the whole world for me. And so, I got to know people. I met a lot of really kind and wonderful people who picked me up in the middle of the night. I mean, people would pick me up at, I remember being picked up in the mountains in North Carolina at about 1 o'clock in the morning. And I got a ride with a guy to Charleston. And so we drove through the night together and just talked about life. Those, I'd say, that was the first formative influence on me was hitchhiking. And then, I don't know if you or your listeners are interested, but I ended up over the course of the next 3 or 4 years hitchhiking all over the United States. And so I did a lot of hitchhiking, particularly out west in Colorado, Utah, New Mexico, Arizona. And would typically hitchhike. I mean, I would often hitchhike from Colorado back to Canada, back to Ontario. These were often long trips. I did these trips, Garrett, for two reasons. First was to discover America, the country that I loved, and secondly, to discover myself. Those 3 or 4 years were undoubtedly, I think, the most formative years of my life. When I really came to decide who I was and who I wanted to be. When you are stuck in the mountains of Colorado in the middle of January on a small secondary highway at 2 o'clock in the mountain, and the snow drifts are 15 feet high on both sides, and the only thing you can hear are coyotes or wolves and other potentially dangerous animals, you really get to figure out what's important in life. You get to figure out who and what you are and what you want to be. But again, just like my trips through Appalachia, I got to know real America. Those hitchhiking trips just solidified my love for the United States.
So that's really interesting. I think most people, when they say, I want to go to the United States, and this is still true today, they don't think Appalachia, right? They don't think the Rockies. They don't think the Cascades. They want to do New York and then maybe up to Boston, and they'll wind their way back down to D.C., and then maybe they'll go to San Francisco and Los Angeles and do sort of the big cities. Brad, can you sort of pinpoint what it was about these sort of, isolated areas that, at least to the young man that you were back then, that was so appealing that you felt like was real America?
Yeah, so I actually never really had any interest in going to cities. And certainly during my hitchhiking years, I never went to cities, and really throughout my adult life. And I've basically now been living in the United States since 1979. I've been living here full time. And to this day, if I'm given a choice between, going to some rural area in the middle of Kansas or Idaho, I would much rather go and explore places where, I don't want to say where real people are, because real people are real everywhere, but it is more likely to be the case that people living in rural America share a love of the United States that I share, and they probably almost certainly share the kinds of values that I respect the most. So, one of the things that always attracted me to the United States from the time I think I was in high school was this notion of rugged individualism. Part of this was because the culture in which I grew up, going up through high school, was not a culture of individualism of any sort. It was a culture of conformism. And the thing that I hated most in life at that time, and still to this day, is conformism to the collective, whether that collective be the group or be a race, be an ethnicity, or just cliques in high school. I've always wanted to go my own way. I wanted to sort of forge my own path in life. And so it's still in rural America that you see this, where you see people who live out this idea of rugged individualism. And by rugged individualism, I mean people who are self-governing in the fullest sense of the term. That is to say, they would prefer not to be governed or ruled by other people and by the government in particular. And so they largely live, and they would certainly, I think, prefer to live without the reach, without seeing, smelling, or touching government officials. The idea of rugged individualism is probably the single most unique feature of the American way of life. There is no French version of rugged individualism, right? There is no Italian version of rugged individualism. It's a uniquely American feature. That's been a big part of my fascination. And, you know, and I much prefer to associate with just regular folk, not people with elite pretensions.
You know, it's really interesting because you're at Clemson now, which is a bit of a unique university in my estimation. I mean, it's sort of in the extreme northwestern part of South Carolina, kind of in the mountains of western South Carolina. But yet you've taught at some of the nation's premier, if we want to use that phrase, right? Harvard and Princeton and other places. And you decided to use an interesting contrast in the name for your newsletter and Substack, which is Redneck Intellectual. You don't sound like a redneck. Not too many rednecks have taught at places like Princeton and Harvard and end up at a fantastic school in South Carolina. Brad, tell me why Redneck Intellectual, because I think a lot of people think that's a bit of a contrast there.
Yeah, it's because I have a kind of natural repulsion of people who consider themselves to be, quote, intellectuals, right? And universities, more than any other institution in the United States, is full of people who consider themselves to be, quote, intellectuals. And as a result, they are a class of people who I would characterize as the hoity-toity, the artsy-fartsy, and the namby-pamby. And to be perfectly frank, I don't regard, you know, sort of 80% of all academics to be intellectuals, if we're to take that term seriously at all. I think many academics are just complete time punchers, and basically they just view their job as a part of the professoriate, as just a clock punching, time punching job. They don't live the life of the mind. So the name, the Redneck Intellectual, it's meant to be a send up of the idea of an intellectual, right? And, you know, why can't there be redneck intellectuals? And the way that I put it, Garrett, is that if given a choice between going to a cocktail party of university faculty members or sitting around a trailer park with a bunch of rednecks pit fire drinking beers every day, all day, I'll take sitting around the trailer park with the so-called rednecks than I will going to a faculty cocktail party.
Brad, you have got to be the most popular man at faculty senate meetings. Is that an accurate statement or no?
Yeah. If only that were so.
I'm sure. Well, I think you've kind of found yourself then at a kind of an interesting place, because I think Clemson, it's got a unique mix, right? It's kind of, it's in the South. It's probably got some genteel kind of students to it, but it's also got some students that are probably first generation college students who hail from those very trailer parks that you're talking about. It's the same way up in Morgantown at WVU and many other universities, particularly land-grant institutions throughout the South. Do you think, was it intentional that you wanted to find yourself at a place like Clemson instead of a place like Harvard or University of Chicago or something like that?
Well, that's a great question. So it was never my intention to end up at a place like Clemson. Although what is kind of funny, in 1978, when I was a senior in high school, I was actually recruited to go to Clemson on a track and field scholarship. I went somewhere else. So it's funny that, you know, several decades later, I would end up at Clemson. And there's kind of a funny story about my ending up at Clemson. So the year before I came here, I was a visiting faculty member at Princeton. And that year, I had job offers on the table from Princeton, Brown, Notre Dame, and American University, plus Clemson. And I was, frankly, having a difficult time making up my mind where I wanted to go. Every hour on the hour, I was, you know, changing my mind, wringing my hands. And then the night before I had to make the decision, as I was sort of tossing and turning, my wife hit me, as in hit me. And she, you know, she said, "Stop it. You're being a fool. The choice is obvious." And I said, "Oh, really? I didn't know it was so obvious." And she said, "You have to go to Clemson." And I was certain she was going to say, "Let's stay at Princeton." We were there. She was loving it. And she said, "No, you have to go to Princeton." I said, "Well, or you have to go to Clemson." And I said, "Well, why?" And she said, "And I apologize in advance to you and your listeners. This is going to sound very maudlin, but," she said, "you're a change the world kind of guy. And you will have a chance to change the world by going to Clemson, not by staying at Princeton or going to Brown, any, you know, at these hoity-toity universities where you'll just be a professor writing books, blah, blah, blah. But if you go to Clemson, you can go and you can create this new institute, what became the Clemson Institute for the Study of Capitalism," which is and as soon as she said that, it was done. Decision was made. Right. So she clearly played to my vanity. And but she was right. I made the decision that night, and I have, and that was just over 18 years ago, and I've never looked back.
So Brad, you talked a little bit about, you know, you had the National Geographic book and sort of the mountain people of the Americas has sort of started your desire to get out into the depths of real America. You've not talked about yet. Was there a seminal moment that you became a free marketeer? Was there a book, a philosopher, a work of some sort that really kind of started you down that intellectual path?
Yeah, good question. So I can tell you in all sincerity and honesty that my politics have never changed from the time I was probably 14, you know, when I first came to sort of political consciousness. Now, of course, you know, I wasn't very bright or very knowledgeable, certainly during those years, and my ideas were ill-formed. And it was the turning point moment for me personally, intellectually speaking, was when I read a novel called The Fountainhead by Ayn Rand. That book, more than any other book, sort of changed the way I started to think. And it changed the way I started to think about my place in the world and more fundamentally on what the good life is. And so it was reading The Fountainhead first and then followed by Rand's magnum opus, Atlas Shrugged. You know, those two books more than any others, I think, really changed. They didn't so much change the way I thought, but they certainly deepened the way I thought, and they did a fabulous job of explaining the world to me in a way that I had not understood before.
I endorse both books as well. They certainly played a key role in my intellectual formations. And this question, feel free to question the premise of this next question, because I'm not sure if I even believe it necessarily, but do you try to teach students sort of the ideas of freedom and free markets in a different way based on where they come from? So I'm thinking in terms of, would you approach teaching the ideas of Rand or Milton Friedman or von Mises or Hayek or whomever it is different from somebody coming from like a fourth generation Boston Brahmin type of family versus a young, smart, ambitious kid coming right out of their trailer park? Or are the ideals of freedom so universal that they're taught in sort of the same way? Does that question even make sense to you?
Yeah, no, it makes sense. And for me to give a decent answer to it, I'd have to think about it a little bit. But I would say two things in response. I would say the first thing is that the ideas presented in these books and many others that support a free society, they appeal to universal principles. Universal principles that I think can be understood by anybody of any social class, any ethnicity, and from any part of the world. And then the second thing I would say is that every young person has a mind. And as long as that mind is open to ideas, then they are accessible, right? So there's a sense in which I guess I would say, I mean, the harder person to whom one might want to introduce these ideas is not the kid from the trailer park. It's the kid from Cambridge, Massachusetts. Those students are much, much more difficult to reach because they have gone to the best, most elite prep schools, to, you know, the best universities where they have been indoctrinated in a set of ideas which it is virtually difficult, if not impossible, to break them from. Whereas, you know, somebody from, so in South Carolina, there's a region here in sort of the low country called the PD region, you know, and it's a low income region of the United States, of South Carolina. It's very poor. It's very rural. I think those students are much, much more open to new ideas than those who have come from the social elite of this country. And frankly, I would prefer to teach those students than the hoity-toity students, you know, from the privileged elite. The kids from rural areas, first of all, typically tend to have a much greater appreciation for the values of the United States, right? You know, you don't have students in rural West Virginia burning the American flag. You don't have, right, where, you know, which you do, of course, you know, when you go to the liberal elite urban areas of the United States. So kids from rural areas typically tend to have a greater both understanding of an appreciation for the values of on which this country was founded. So I would actually much rather teach those students.
So first of all, I agree with you 100%. I think there's just no doubt about that. But I don't have a theory as to why that is. I mean, why do you think people coming from rural areas or flyover country or whatever slightly pejorative term we want to throw at them, why are they more open to these ideas? There's nothing to me that's obvious necessarily.
Yeah, it's actually less that they're open to these ideas. It's more that they are accustomed to these ideas, right? So these are the ideas that they think are normal. These are the ideas that they think stand for what America is and ought to be, right? So it's these ideas that have been born and bred into them. They typically tend to be much, much more open to the ideas of a free society relative to a young man or a woman who has gone to, you know, Choate boarding school in New England and then went to Yale. Those students are essentially impenetrable. It's very difficult to reach students at elite academic institutions with what we might call the philosophy of Americanism. Because the philosophy of Americanism is anathema to everything that is taught in American higher education today. All right? America's intellectual elites, I mean, let's just call it what it is. They hate America, right? They hate America. They hate capitalism. They hate freedom. And they are, you know, and have been now for decades. They've been trying to tear down all of the institutions in this country that have been the source of America's greatness, and they're succeeding.
Have you noticed, you said you got to Clemson, what, 1979, is that right?
Not to Clemson. No, I came to the United States.
I was going to say, you didn't look that old.
Yeah. I moved to the United States in 1979.
Yep. Okay. So, and you got to Clemson when? What year?
2005. So just before I met you.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So that's only 19 years. Have you noticed a difference in students arriving at Clemson? I don't necessarily mean like they have higher test scores or something like that, because, you know, I'm sure that the school has become more successful at attracting quote unquote better students as the football team has gotten better. We've seen the same thing at the University of Alabama. But I'm curious, in just sort of the demeanor and the receptivity and the conscientiousness, I mean, have you noticed an evolution in Clemson students for better or worse?
Yes, I have noticed the difference. And most particularly in the last 3 years. So COVID changed everything. COVID and the lockdowns have traumatized an entire generation of young men and women, and young men in particular. And I do see this with some regularity. I mean, you now have students who are entering university, you know, who for a year and a half didn't go to school and basically had no learning. And, you know, they were isolated in their homes, and they lost many of the skills necessary to succeed in life. So, yeah, so just, but it's really only been in the last 3 years that I've noticed a real difference in our students. And, you know, as the government schools continue to get worse, which they do, with every passing year, particularly kids who are coming from government schools, the quality of their education goes down and down and down. Now, I will say, on the flip side, however, there is a fabulous new trend in the United States. Two related trends. The first is homeschooling. So we see a lot more homeschooled kids than ever before. And the homeschooled kids are fantastic. They are absolutely fantastic. They are much, much better educated than students who go to government schools. And furthermore, they are self-starters. And that's really important to be, you know, a self, in many ways, self-educated and self-starting students. We're also seeing students now who have attended classical charter and private schools. And these students tend to get really, really good educations as well. In the program that I run at Clemson, the Lyceum Scholars Program, we've had a massive uptick in the last couple of years of students who are coming out of these classical charter and private schools. And they are really, really well educated, and they absolutely have a leg up on kids coming from the government schools.
So when you say classical, I know what you mean. There's a certain focus on logic and rhetoric and Latin and Greek. I mean, what is it about those? It's not immediately obvious to the average person on the street why studying Latin and Greek is a better use of one's time than studying social studies or American studies or any number of different subjects. What is it about the timelessness of a classical education that serves people well today, you think?
Right. So, first of all, it's the rigor. It's the serious training of a mind. So very few students in high school, even coming from these classical schools, are actually doing ancient Greek. But a lot of them are doing Latin. And what does Latin require? Latin requires just a lot of serious, intense work. There's a lot of memorization involved. And memorization requires focus. And so the skill that one learns, in addition, I mean, to the language, which is, of course, at the root of all Romance languages and the English language, it teaches young people how to focus the mind. That's one. But most importantly, at least in what I experience, is that these kids who are at classical, charter, and private schools, and I mean, the biggest movement in the homeschool world is the classical homeschool model. And what that means is they're just reading the best literature of Western civilization, right? They're reading when they're in elementary school or of elementary school age. They're reading the best children's literature that has been written over the course of the last 2,500 years. And by the time they get to high school, they are reading, we have kids applying to our Lyceum program, you know, who in high school have read Plato, Aristotle, Machiavelli, Locke. And that, where does that happen in the government schools? It doesn't. You know, the reading of these texts, they do, does two important things. First, again, like studying Latin, it just trains the mind. I mean, these books are so much, much more difficult than any of the garbage that that kids are required to read in the government schools. It just forces you, and this goes to the second point, it forces you to focus and concentrate on a much higher level than you would if you're reading the trite that is used at all levels in the government schools. Not to mention, of course, you know, and so in other words, it's great books. And the great books ask, what's important about the great books? Well, it's that the great books ask and answer, or at least attempt to answer, the great questions, the fundamental questions of human life. And so it also has the effect of deepening the soul. So these kids are just, who are trained with a classical education, they're getting superior educations. And there is no government school in the United States that has a classical curriculum.
Well, and it seems to me too that oftentimes when you're going through a government school or just a traditional public school, you're not being trained to live life. You're being trained to pick A, B, C, or D, right? And life is not necessarily like, can I figure out which of these multiple choice answers I need to bubble in, right? And whenever you say like deepening the soul, I'm going to ask you to define it, but I'm going to recognize that that's a very tough thing to define. You kind of feel what it means more than almost know what it means. But when you say classical education deepens the soul, what are you trying to say with that? Because I think that's a very, very profound way of putting it.
Yeah, it causes you to think seriously and deeply about the most fundamental questions. So, you know, if you're a high school student reading Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics, and you're reading the two books or chapters, let's say at the end, about friendship. I mean, no book has ever been written that discusses the nature of friendship more deeply than Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics. And so it causes you to ask all kinds of really fundamental, it forces you to ask the most fundamental question, which you would otherwise never ask of yourself, namely, what is friendship, right? And so when you ask the question, what is friendship? Well, then the first thing you do is, you know, you define a few of its obvious qualities and characteristics, but then you also contrast it with other forms, other kinds of relationship. You contrast what friendship is with what it means to be a brother or a sister or a son or a daughter or a neighbor or an employee, all of which are relationships, right? But there's something unique about what friendship is. So, you know, you start to realize, oh, friendship has the following, you know, qualities and characteristics. First of all, friendship, unlike, say, being a brother or a sister, friendship is a choice. You have to choose who your friends are. And when you choose who your friends are, you have to have certain criteria. So you have to know then what are the criteria by which I choose Bobby or Susie to be my friends? And what are the criteria by which persons X, Y, and Z are not my friends, right? And then you also begin to realize that there are certain levels of friendship, right? There's kind of the inner sanctum sanctorum of friends, you know, those two or three people who are your closest friends, and they're your closest friends in part because they share the same values that you share, and because you trust them. Numbers 9 and 10 on your hierarchy of friends list, you know, they may not share the same quite all of the same values. And for many different reasons, you may not trust them. So anyway, it's these books, and you know, you could be talking about friendship, you could be talking about the nature of courage, you could be talking about justice, right? And these books, they really focus the mind on first asking, what is this thing, right? What is courage?
Yeah, that's so well said.
And of course, what is courage relative to cowardice, right? So one of the questions that I ask often of my students when they come to my office, we have in our Lyceum Scholars Program, we have something that we call the Socratic Tutor Program. So each one of our Lyceum Scholars is assigned what we call a Socratic Tutor. It's a faculty member who meets with his or her tutees every other week for about an hour. And we have these really intense conversations, one-on-one conversations with our students. One of the questions that I will sometimes ask of a student, but only if it's a student that I know well, have had in class before, and think can handle the following question. And so they'll come in, sit down. The question will be, so Garrett, why are you a moral coward? Okay. Like, I mean, you know, that question is typically a conversation stopper, right?
Right. Yeah.
And the reaction of the student at first is to be maybe offended. Like, it's either to be offended or it's to think to themselves, well, how did you know? And so we start playing around. I start asking all kinds of questions about this. You know, I mean, what is cowardice? What does it mean to be moral? And eventually we get around to identifying what the real issue is, which is that most people at some point in their lives, if not on a, you know, semi or if not a regular basis, compromise their values, right? That's what it means to be a moral coward, is somebody who compromises on their moral values with some regularity. And compromising one's moral values can't be a good. It prevents us from being the best that we can be, right? And we should always strive to be the best that we can be in all parts of our lives. Most people compromise even just a little tiny bit. And the question is why? Why do we compromise? And so in these conversations, and which are instigated by these books, right, we can ask those questions. And when you ask that question of yourself, that it's only when you ask that question of yourself that you can first answer it and come to know the reasons why. And it's only then that you can overcome your moral cowardice.
So about 10 different ways I could go with this. I think I would say, too, like great literature, it also gives you the tools through which you can more accurately evaluate the world around you, right? To do one example, ever since I read Atlas Shrugged, I begin to look for the Howard Warks of the world, or the Wesley Mooches of the world, or the Dagny Taggarts, and not just because they're avatars for something else, but because great literature does such a great job of describing these types of people, why they are making the decisions they're making, the incentive structure that's often in place for these types of people, right? And so I think you're less likely to become a victim in certain ways, right? Or to be compromised by certain types of people because you know the different types of people that are out there in the world and what their various incentive structures happen to look like.
Absolutely, without question. I just finished teaching last week Dostoevsky's fabulous novel, Crime and Punishment. Dostoevsky, like Ayn Rand, has memorable characters. And in these characters, I mean, you see the spectrum of really, you see the spectrum of human nature and you see the spectrum of moral characters, you know, and students will naturally come to identify with some characters. They'll hate other characters. And in some cases, I think the most interesting case is that they will come to see themselves in They'll come to see themselves in many ways in a less favorable way. So for instance, I'll give you an example. So next week, You mentioned Howard Roark. Next week, I will be teaching at Clemson Ayn Rand's novel, The Fountainhead. And of course, the protagonist in The Fountainhead is this character, Howard Roark, and his antagonist is Peter Keating. Howard Roark is a man of extraordinary independence, integrity, and honesty, right? He is somebody to emulate. He's almost like a Greek god. So what Rand has done is to provide a model of how we might be, how we might act. On the other hand, and so it's inspiring, right? This character, Howard Roark, inspires us to be better than we are. But the other character, the antagonist, Peter Keating, by contrast, is a total compromiser and what Ayn Rand called a second-hander. He lives his life based not on his productive abilities, his productive genius, but rather on compromising and deceiving people. I mean, he's a remarkably dishonest character. And so when my students see Peter Keating, sometimes they see part of themselves in Peter Keating. And Peter Keating is such a repulsive character that, you know, a kid says, well, my gosh, you know, I see a little bit of myself in Peter Keating, and I don't want to be Peter Keating, right? I want to be Howard Roark. And so the novel has the transformative power, right, of helping us to be better than we are. And the same is true, you know, in Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment. There you have a character, Raskolnikov, who is genuinely evil. And it's a brilliant psychological portrayal of the depths of evil. And it's a cautionary tale, you know, of what not to be.
So kind of setting Shakespeare aside for just a second, and we're known for taking detours on this podcast, so this is okay. The Russians seem to have just a particular insight into the human experience. I mean, whether it's Solzhenitsyn or Rand or Tolstoy or Pushkin or Dostoevsky, there's something in the Russian experience. Brad, have you ever thought about what is it about the Russian experience that allows these authors to make such insights? Because it seems like there's more of a concentration in Russian literature of that kind of experience and expertise than perhaps any other kind of literary tradition.
Yeah, so, you know, that's a fabulous question above the pay grade of a redneck intellectual. Okay. that's a fabulous question, and it's a really hard question. And, you know, I'm not a student of Russian cultural life, so I don't have I don't think I have a good answer to that question. But you are right that many of the world's greatest novelists are from Russia. How that is, why that is, that's a great question, but I don't think.
What do you think about this? Just I'll throw this out there. And this is, I think, something else that great books can teach us, that there's value even in suffering. And I think that there's something to be gained from suffering. And I think maybe the Russian experience has a particular insight into human suffering, right?
Well, that's a great answer. Yes. And I'm so glad you mentioned that, because I just spent 2 weeks talking about suffering with my students relative to Crime and Punishment, because suffering becomes suffering, in a sense, it becomes the theme of the novel. There are three or four main characters in the novel who, in one way or another, and to one degree or another, suffer. So it's a novel about suffering. But of course, it's not simply about suffering, because with suffering will always come its opposite, namely hope. So the novel ends. And I mean, you have to read 550 pages until you literally get to the last page of the novel where there is any sense of hope. But that's how the novel ends. It ends with hope. And so I think you're right. I mean, would you want to live in Russia? I mean, who would want to live in Russia? I mean, it's just, you know, I'm sorry. I know Russians, and they're, I know some Russians, and you know, they're sort of wonderful people. And look, I grew up in Canada, right? I know what suffering is. And, you know, partly for the same reasons, you know, it's partly the weather. You know, Canadians are like Russians in that they share two things in common: bad weather and lots of alcohol, right? And so this leads to, you know, a kind of cultural ennui where you know, there's just, you know, people suffer.
Well, I think there's a lot of that, frankly, in a place like Appalachia to an extent, right? I mean, you have the mountains right on top of you. You've got a hard blue-collar job that you hurt at the end of the day when you come home, right? You're sort of, you're told by our ostensibly cultural betters that you're somehow lesser than, right? Because you don't know the word ennui, for example, right? Or something like that. Like it's sort of inculcated into you that you're lesser than sort of your coastal neighbors, and like that manifests in drugs and sometimes alcohol and all these kinds of things. But I think the most successful folks understand that there is hope, that if you can live a life of schedule, of dedication, of discipline, right, that you can actually make a better way for yourself. And so we've got totally far afield, but that's not totally unusual for this conversation. Brad, I have just a couple other questions here for you. So let's say that you're listening to this podcast. You've got a kid who's probably 16, 17 years old. They've gone all through government schools, like, you know, 90% of the population. And there's something gnawing at the back of her head that she doesn't want her kid to miss out on some of the stuff that you and I have been talking about for the last hour. Are there three or four books or authors or just something that you can give that mother, something to point her to that she could put in front of her kids?
Yes. So the first thing that I would recommend any parent to get who has particularly young children, but I mean, children up through the end of high school, there's a book titled The Well-Trained Mind, A Guide to a Classical Education at Home. And the book was intended mostly for homeschoolers, but not entirely for homeschoolers. The book can be used by anybody, whether you have children in a government school or in a private school. And what this book does is that it lays out a full K-12 academic curriculum based on great books, based on, and so, you know, it the most valuable resource of the book is that at every single grade level and in every subject, it provides a list of books for kids to read, and it was our Bible. My wife and I, we homeschooled our three children for 18 years, and it was our go-to book. So that's the first thing I would say, and that one book will have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of, you know, of books, you know, from, you know, kids in kindergarten up through kids in high school. So that's, you know, the first thing I would recommend. And, you know, there's just so many great books.
It's like choosing your favorite kid, right? It's a little bit, it's a little bit difficult.
It is. But I would say, I'll just add one other thing. The social profile in the United States today that is suffering the most, I would say, would be boys and young men, right? We have a serious problem in this country with disaffected young men, you know, who are basically turning off and tuning out. It's a great tragedy, you know. In the worst cases, of course, you know, they're turning to drugs, right? If you drive through Kensington and Philadelphia, for instance, I don't know if you've ever seen the videos of it's like the, you know, the TV show The Walking Dead. I mean, literally, these people are all on meth, various other drugs, and so we have an epidemic in this country. We have an epidemic of particularly young men who are abusing drugs and alcohol, and in the worst cases, of course, committing suicide. And not to mention a generation of young boys who are going into their schools and committing mass murder, right? So there's a serious, serious problem in this country with our young men. And I mean, what would you expect when you live in a nation of fatherless children, right? That is, I think, probably the greatest single social problem in the United States is fatherless children. And of course, the problem of fatherless children was created beginning in the 1960s with the introduction of the welfare state. Well, the welfare system, more than any other single cause, has led to the destruction of the American family, and to this generation of lost boys. You know, I mean, the one thing in life, right? The one thing we know from all over the world throughout all history, right, is that fatherless, a generation of fatherless boys is a generation of boys and then young men who will be both self-destructive and destructive of others. And that is the crisis. That is certainly the social crisis of the time in which we live today.
Oh, this is so interesting. I just had a conversation with a friend today about exactly this, the crisis of fatherlessness in our country. Brad, it's probably obvious on some level, but I think society sort of says that men are becoming less and less necessary in certain ways. Make the case that fathers are not only necessary, but they're actually essential to a flourishing America. What is it about a father? And you sort of spoke to this a little bit on your website, cbradleythompson.com. You have an article about fathers and sons, and I want to get into that here in just a second. But what is it about a father that a mother just cannot replicate? God bless him.
Yeah. And this is true for both, you know, I mean, every boy and every girl deserves a mother, and every boy and every girl deserves a father, right? And there is a division of labor, a social division of labor between mothers and fathers, right? They play different roles in the raising of children. They play different but necessary roles in developing well-rounded human beings. And you know, the things that fathers bring to the table are motivation, discipline, strength, integrity, right? And so let me speak in particular of young men, boys and young men. You know, and this is something I wrote about in the article that you mentioned. I think it's titled Fathers and Sons American Style is the title of my essay, which is on my Substack. And you know, it's a remarkable thing. You know, every day every year we celebrate Father's Day, right? Which is a great thing. We should celebrate Father's Day and Mother's Day. But what we never talk about is what it means to be a son in America, right? To be a son in America is very different than to be a father. In America, the land of freedom and hope, the promise of American life for every father of every generation going back to the beginning of the United States has had the hope and the expectation that his son will do better than he has, right? And that has borne fruit, borne true over the course of 250 years of American history, right? That is the promise of American life. And of course, that's not true today anymore. It's not true that fathers can expect their sons to be better off, to be more successful than they. Every father wants his son to have a better life than he did, right? And that is the promise of American life. But I will also say that, you know, there is this sort of unspoken bond, right, that we have. And I think this is probably true worldwide, not just in the United States, right? But there's an unspoken bond between fathers and sons. And certainly in the United States, you know, there is this remarkable phenomenon in the United States where you have grown men who are CEOs of major companies, who are major sports stars, you know, who have reached the pinnacles of success in their lives, and who have known other great people. But what's most interesting to me is that these men always feel a certain degree of inferiority relative to their own fathers. It's a really interesting dynamic. Right? How it is that somebody, you know, who is the CEO of a company still feels inferior to his father, who was a janitor, you know, at a local plant, right? And that's because, you know, there's this unique relationship developed between fathers and sons, where, I mean, sons literally look up to their fathers. I mean, literally look up, as in, you know, staring up. When you're 5 years old, looking at this man who is your model of what it means to be a man. There's a video that's been going around, a couple of videos recently going around, asking Tom Brady, you know, the GOAT of the NFL, you know, is asked, I think by a boy in a press conference, by a kid, who's your hero? And there's this long pause, and then Brady looks at this kid, stares at him intently, and then he gets all choked up, and he says, my father. And then there's another video of Cristiano Ronaldo, the great, you know, Portuguese soccer player, again, you know, asked who his hero is, and to talk about his father, and he just breaks down sobbing. Right, it's a very interesting phenomenon, and it's an extraordinary phenomenon, and any civilization that breaks the connection between fathers and sons is doomed to fail.
Jordan Peterson is a fellow Canadian, has talked a little bit about this. One of his points is that this sort of crisis of boys and men is because society has refrained or hesitates to demand anything of them, to put any response. We don't want a burden. We use that phrase, burden of responsibility, on young men. Do you kind of buy into that? And do you think maybe that's another key piece that fathers play, is they demand more of their sons than perhaps what their mothers do?
Yes, absolutely. Well, they demand it in different ways, right? Mothers can be demanding in their own way.
Sure, absolutely.
Most boys fear their mothers more than they do their fathers, with good reason. Fathers, this is what I meant by fathers providing motivation. It's typically fathers who set a high bar for a son in particular, let's say. And fathers just have very high expectations. I mean, like you can see this. You only have to go to a little league baseball game, soccer game, football game, hockey game, and you see the relationship between fathers and sons on an athletic field. It's really quite interesting. You know, these little 6-year-old boys, 10-year-old boys, 16-year-old boys, if their father is on the sidelines or in the stands watching, you watch the kid. They're always looking over to see if their father is watching and approving.
Oh, absolutely. Okay, Brad, we have two questions left. So let's say somebody, they log on Redneck Intellectual, they read a couple of your articles. What is it that you hope people get from your Substack? What do you want them to take away from it?
Right. So I have three different features on the Substack. The first and most important is the long form essays, right? So this essay, Fathers and Sons. And I've been for the last year writing a series of essays on the nature and meaning of America. So that's the first thing. Those are the most important things. But I've also wrote a series of 14 essays on K-12 education in the United States, and then just on a lot of different political, cultural, moral subjects. And I would say the purpose, you know, of those essays is just to inspire Americans, and really basically anybody, because I have people from around the world who follow me on Substack. And it's just to take your life seriously, to take your life as something that's been given to you, and you have just one life, and your greatest moral responsibility is first to yourself to make your life the best that it can possibly be. Only when you are the best that you can possibly be can you be the best husband, the best father, the best son. So, connected with that, the promotion of what I think is the philosophy of Americanism on the site. Then I have these two other features. One is called Dumb and Dumber, which is a kind of aggregator blog for all things education in America, K-12 and higher education. And then the other feature is called The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, which is a biweekly news roundup of what's going on in the news.
All right. Last question, sir. What's next? You're working on a new book. Have you given any thought? It's been, what, maybe 5 years since your last book. What are you going to do now?
Good question. So there are several books at various stages of completion. So my last book was called America's Revolution. My last major academic book was called America's Revolutionary Mind. I'm now working on a book that will be titled America's Constitutional Mind. I'm about three quarters of the way through that. I should also mention, and this is something I'm quite pleased with, I've started a press called Loco Foco Press. Loco Foco Press last June published a little book of mine that your listeners might be interested in, titled What America Is. It's a collection of essays on all things American. And Loco Foco Press is going to be publishing a lot of other books of mine, sort of less academic, more public access books of mine and other authors. So anyway, that's what's going on in my world.
Good stuff. All right. C. Bradley Thompson, professor of political philosophy at Clemson University. Where could people keep track of you? Do you have a Twitter account? Do you have a Facebook? How can people keep in touch?
Yeah. So I'm on Twitter. I can never quite remember the Twitter handle. Just search C. Bradley Thompson, or I think it's at C. Bradley Thompson1. And then also on my Substack, which is the Redneck Intellectual. It's that cbradleythompson.substack.com, or you can just, easiest way to do is just Google the Redneck Intellectual.
All right. Fantastic, sir. Thank you so much for this broad and wide ranging conversation. I have no doubt our listeners will enjoy it. And again, just thank you for coming on this episode of Forgotten America. It's been a real pleasure, sir.
Thanks for joining us for this week's conversation. Don't forget to subscribe to Forgotten America wherever you get your podcasts. If you liked this episode, please leave a review on iTunes. And if you would like to support the production of this podcast, you can become a patron of the Cardinal Institute on Patreon or donate at www.cardinalinstitute.com/donate.